Welcome, everyone. We are very excited to have you here today, this afternoon, about noontime for us here in the central United States. We have guests coming with us from France who will be on us during this call. This is probably the most special webinar that we've hosted in the current days of Zoom platforms and virtual calling about the documentary short Colette, an Oscar-winning documentary that I found to be the most profound 25 minutes of film that I've ever watched. And it's not just because of the museum's connection and our own personal connections that we've forged with Colette over the last 7 years that we've been working with her. Before I get into the full introductions in the program, a few details on how we'll operate. We want this to be a Q&A with the audience for the last portion of it. We're gonna go through and get some input from historians, from battlefield guides, and most importantly, from Colette herself. There'll be a Q&A that you'll see on your screen. You can use that Q&A to ask any questions that we'll be screening throughout the program that we'll ask of our battlefield guides, the filmmakers, and of Colette herself. So if you joined in, Anthony Giacconi, who is the director of the film, is not with us today. He fell ill, sends his regards, wishes he could be here, just not able to make it today. So with this, I'm gonna stop the share of our screen, introduce our panel today. Just sort of going around on my screen, we have several great individuals, great friends of the museum, including battlefield guide Christoph Gosselin, who's been taking our Easy Company tours many, many times a year, taking Americans through Normandy. We have Pierre Samuel Natanson, who you'll see with Colette, also a battlefield guide, works on our D-Day tours. He'll be serving as interpreter for Colette today, posing our questions to her and giving her responses back. We have Elise Dwyer, a French producer, has an extensive biography of films that she has worked on. Some of these that stuck out that are perfect for the story that they told with Colette, things like Resistance Women, the fight against Hitler in Berlin, special for the BBC. So she has a great list of credits to her name and will give us some insight onto the filmmaking process. James Jimmy Matteo played Frank Percante in the miniseries Band of Brothers. He'll be with us to sort of moderate when we get to the filmmaking, the technical aspects of how this film was made and what gave it such an emotional pull, an emotional draw for all of its viewers and helping bring Colette's story to life. And most importantly, Colette Morin-Caterin, 92 years old, veteran of the French Resistance, has been discussing her experience under German occupation, her family's experience, her years since, with guests, visitors traveling on World War II museum tours from high school students to retirees since 2014. In fact, we even brought her to New Orleans in November 2014 for our international conference where she told her story in a ballroom of 600 plus individuals. I'd be remiss if I did not mention our largest failure with Colette is that she did not get to see the Mississippi River during her time here. It's something that we hope to remedy in the future, that she can see that the Mississippi goes much wider than the Seine. To sort of get us started on this aspect of film and memory, I'd like to bring on Jimmy Matteo now to talk about the power of film and the legacy that he's experienced over the last 20 years.
Well, first off, hello, everyone, and hello, Colette and Pierre. This is, first, let me just say, when Nathan first asked me to do this, I think of all the things, and I've been around a lot of people, and I've been blessed with some amazing moments around some iconic filmmakers and decorated war heroes, but today's event is very special for me. You know, Colette and her story, her courage, of strength, and it's just remarkable. So first of all, I'm humbled to be a part of this and of this panel, and even asked to be on this panel. So thank you very, very much. respectively, I'm gonna keep this brief because I notice it's not about me and film and Band of Brothers and all that stuff. But 20 years ago, as a young boy, I became part of something so big and so unique and so important into who I am today. and that was having the great honor of portraying Sergeant Frank Picanti in the HBO miniseries, Band of Brothers. This show opened my eyes to a lot of things, but it more or less it opened to a bigger world outside New York City in the streets that I grew up on. This started as an acting job, and everybody knows that's transpired into an appreciation for everyone who was affected by conflict and paid the price for freedom. So going through, I'd be happy to answer any one of your questions about Band of Brothers, the filmmaking aspect, particularly in episode 9, Why We Fight, which is when Easy Company stumbles upon the concentration camps. I'm going to end with this real quick. One thing I'm very sure of, never in my life will I embark on a more important acting job, never. The necessity to tell stories, as we all know, and educating our youth is critically, critically important. And, you know, to me, our youth cannot suffer a disconnect from this. So, and I think the World War II educational travel programs have been life-changing to many. I mean, I've witnessed it. I've been a part of it. I've been on these tours and the importance of them. So, and I've been affected by it firsthand. And I also, you know, the great work that the World War II Museum is doing and keeping us all connected to history, is immeasurable. And I thank you all for allowing me to experience all that you guys have allowed me to. So, like I said, again, I'm humbled to be here. I will answer any questions. I know a lot of people on this panel. I could talk forever about certain things, but I am out of my league with this. To some degree, I just feel so, you know, like I said, honored and privileged to just be here and hear the story. Now, you know, this is going to be pretty life-changing for me. So thank you guys for allowing me to be on. I'll answer any questions that you have.
Okay. And thank you, Jimmy. And we'll get to questions at the end, but we'll come back to you for your comments on how this film looked from a technical standpoint, something you're very able and to comment on and something that would be very appreciated. But I want to get into Colette now. And the documentary that most of you have seen, if you're viewing this, we sent the link out to watch it. It captures just a small slice of Colette's life. But we want to find out more about Colette and her backstory and what she did under the German occupation and how her life turned out. So I want to ask Colette now to introduce herself in kind of the manner that she does when we're sitting around a dinner table in Normandy. And Pierre will serve as interpreter.
Nathan demande de vous présenter de la manière dont vous présentez quand on est avec des groupes du musée et un peu sur votre histoire familiale.
Alors, je m'appelle Colette Marin-Catherine et je suis née le 25 avril 1929. C'est une année exceptionnelle.
So her name is Colette Marin-Catherine and she was born on the 25th of April 1929, a truly exceptional year.
Il y a eu deux grands événements.
Two major events happened that year.
Le krach financier mondial.
The Wall Street crash.
Et ma naissance.
And her birth.
Alors, mes parents étaient industriels de l'automobile et leur affaire était sur la Nationale 13, Paris-Cherbourg, Cambaieux ou Paris-Cherbourg, comme vous voudrez.
So her parents had a business in the automotive industry and transport and their business was on the, and they lived by the main road from Paris to Cherbourg, the national road number 13.
Alors, parfaitement normal pour moi jusqu'à mes 11 ans.
Everything was perfectly normal in her life until she was 11.
Et le pays a décidé de déclarer la guerre. Ça m'a un peu perturbé.
Until France went to war and she was a little disturbed by that.
Voilà. Parce que tous les conducteurs, tous les chauffeurs, tous les mécaniciens, les 22 employés de l'entreprise ont tous été mobilisés, même le jardinier, parce que c'était d'âge à être mobilisé.
So all the, in her parents' business, all the drivers, all the mechanics, even the gardener was drafted into the army.
Et tout ce qui pouvait rouler, tous les camions, tous les véhicules, même les voitures privées, ont été réquisitionnés.
And all the trucks, anything that could be driven, was also requisitioned.
Sauf un camion benne basculante, un 10 tonnes benne basculante, parce que ce n'était pas un camion dans lequel on pouvait transporter des troupes.
With the exception of a dump truck, one single truck, because it couldn't be used to transport troops.
Alors, avec ce camion, mon père a d'abord été réquisitionné par la ville de Caen, par la préfecture, pour faire des voyages pour approvisionner la ville de Caen en denrées.
So, with this single truck, her father was requisitioned to do supply trips to the city of Caen.
Ensuite, quand les Allemands sont arrivés, il a été réquisitionné à nouveau, mais par la TOD, au service de ce qui lui a permis d'approcher, en transportant du matériel naturellement de construction, d'approcher tous les blocos et les fonds de construction de la côte d'Anglais.
After the German invasion of France, her father was again requisitioned with that truck, but this time for the TOT organization that built defenses on the coast. And this allowed Colette's father to approach all of the bunkers and the defenses on the coast.
Ça lui a permis, c'était un photographe qui tirait lui-même ses photos, parce qu'à l'époque c'était en Argentine, pas le pays, mais la pellicule était une Argentine. Et il tirait lui-même ses photos. Et les photos sont remontées à Caen dans les services de la résistance. Et elles ont fait leur voyage, comme beaucoup d'autres d'ailleurs, parce qu'il n'y a pas une seule personne qui ait envoyé les plans de l'Atlantique.
He was a photographer and took pictures and would develop the pictures himself and then send the pictures back to Caen and then through channels all the way to the Allies. Him and many others did that to get the complete picture of the Atlantic War.
Et c'est comme ça que pour nous la guerre a commencé.
And that's really how the war started for them.
One thing I wanted to say to Colette is she's been speaking to students for so many years for us, and a professor from Nicholls State University in Thibodaux, Louisiana, Kurt Stiegler, she may remember the name, he sent some quotes from the students who had met her, and this will lead into the next part of Colette's story. But a student, Christine, in 2017 wrote in her post-trip journal, "I thought Colette was an amazing woman. When my friend thanked her for everything that she did, she responded, 'No, thank you. If it was not for you, the Americans, I would be speaking German right now.' Colette was such a humble and beautiful human being, and she was one of my favorite parts of the trip." From Christine in 2017, 19 years old at the time that she wrote that. I want to talk to Colette about the experience of liberation, what she first noticed on June 6, 1944.
Nathan vous demande votre expérience de la libération et quelle était votre première expérience le 6 juin 1944.
Tout le monde me demande toujours ce que j'ai fait le 6 juin 1944. Ça fait rire Christophe. Ben, je vais répondre rien.
So everybody always asks her what she did on June 6th, voilà. And this makes Christophe voilà. Laughs because he knows the answer, but she always says absolutely nothing.
Le soir, j'ai fait la vaisselle comme d'habitude.
On that evening, she washed the dishes just like every other day.
Sauf que je vais vous raconter une anecdote que j'ai écrite, que je dis dans nos... Mm-hmm. Hein?
She does have one anecdote that she tells during when she meets group from the museum.
Bon, j'étais devant la maison et vous ne connaissez pas Christophe connaît bien la route de Bayeux à Bréguilongueil tout droit. Et quand on vient de Caen, à la sortie du village, il y a une route que l'on prend à droite qui va vers la côte.
So
qui va dans les petits villages de la côte.
Absolutely. She was standing in front of her house that evening, and it's on a long straight road, the main road from Caen to Bayeux, and at the end of the village, there's a turn on the right heading towards the coast. There's another road heading towards the coast.
Il y avait personne dans le village parce que on entendait quand même au loin les bombardements. Il y avait le Havre, il y avait Caen. On entendait, on était des... comme par hasard. Moi, j'étais sur le trottoir parce qu'il y avait strictement personne dans les rues.
There was no one was in the street. Nobody was walking around because they could hear the bombardments on the coast in Le Havre and the bombardment in Caen. So she was standing in the street because there was no one else there.
J'ai vu surgir de cette route qui était à droite. J'ai vu surgir un sidecar, ce qui n'avait rien d'extraordinaire. Tous les Allemands se baladaient en sidecar.
So she saw, and then she saw a motorcycle with a sidecar appear, which by itself, in itself, was nothing exceptional. The Germans were always riding around with motorcycles and sidecars.
Mais dès qu'il a eu fait quelques dizaines de mètres vers moi, immédiatement, j'ai vu que c'était pas normal, car dans la nacelle, je voyais un amant, un temps, je voyais des garnitures dorées, enfin des casquettes dorées.
And as the motorcycle and sidecar got closer, within a couple of dozen yards, she noticed something was wrong because in the sidecar was a what she described as a form, yeah, with some glitter, some decoration, some on it.
Et au guidon, un homme débraillé, un soldat débraillé et sans casque.
And driving the motorcycle was a soldier, but he was all rough, no, or close to on, etc. And he didn't have a helmet.
Alors, le casque, je pense qu'ils ne quittaient pas leur casque, même pour aller aux toilettes. Ils ne les quittaient jamais.
The German soldiers would never leave their helmet, even to go to the toilets.
Et ils se sont approchés de moi et ils m'ont demandé, parce qu'en définitive, ils venaient de la côte, là. Et l'officier qui était agonisant, il n'a pas dû arriver vivant au camp parce qu'il était vraiment agonisant. La casquette était tombée sur la roue de secours.
So they approached and there was a wounded officer agonizing in the sidecar. He probably never made it alive to Caen, and he was wounded, and his cap had fallen on the spare wheel at the back of the sidecar.
Et cherchait la route de Caen parce qu'il ne s'était pas repéré. Bayeux, il fallait tourner à droite. Caen, il fallait tourner à gauche. Donc je les ai envoyés à Caen, qui n'était pas libéré, mais je pense qu'il devait déjà le savoir. Et je répète, je pense que cet homme-là n'est pas arrivé vivant à Caen. C'est les derniers Allemands libres, officiellement libres, enfin à mourant, que j'ai vus.
They asked her for the road to Caen because they weren't sure which way to go, Bayeux or going towards Bayeux or Caen, which was not liberated yet. And these were the last Germans she saw as free, not prisoners.
Après, les autres Allemands que j'ai vus, ils étaient prisonniers ou morts.
The Germans that she saw later on in the battle were either dead or prisoners. Il vous a demandé extrêmement gentiment
il parlait un mauvais français, mais c'était avec beaucoup de politesse. Alors quand on pense à ce qu'étaient ces gens-là 48 heures avant, avec beaucoup d'orgueil,
d'arrogance,
merci. Mais, voilà, mais sa vie était en danger, alors d'un seul coup ça le rendait très poli.
When these Germans asked her for direction, they were extremely polite and humble and all the forms, etc., in broken French, but very, very polite. And this was very striking compared to how arrogant and violent they would have been only 48 hours earlier.
Il faut dire que les troupes allemandes ont eu un moment de stupéfaction quand ils ont compris que des troupes ennemies pouvaient débarquer sur les côtes.
It has to be said that the German troops were very much stunned when they realized that Allied forces could and were landing on the coast.
dans leur tête, ils pensaient que le mur de l'Atlantique serait totalement infranchissable.
In their head, they were convinced that the Atlantic wall was completely impregnable and impenetrable.
And
she's listening.
And Colette's story being one of, you know, the hundreds, every family in Normandy that was there would have a story of what they saw and heard in June 1944 and beyond. And duty to pass those messages on has now fallen to battlefield guides like Pierre and like Christophe. And I think maybe I'm going to bring Christophe on now, as he has forged a special relationship with Colette through our tours and helped provide the spark for the film that won the Oscar. So Christophe, maybe you want to tell that story of how this all gets started with the documentary.
Yes, you're right. This started with Colette, I should say, with this incredible relationship. You saw that the way she expressed herself, and she's very articulate. And so I was also a translator sometimes when Pierre wasn't available, or Leslie, that we briefly saw earlier, Leslie Coutts wasn't available. So that's the first thing. And then I've been contacted, you know, through emails, because I'm a contractor for the museum. So I'm also an independent tour guide. And Anthony Giacchino, the director, said I was conducting documentaries, plural, in Normandy, and they needed a tour guide to show them around Omaha Beach and around Sainte-Mère-Église. So he sent me two short biographies of two soldiers and say that I'd like to go somewhere in relation or in connection with that. So it was kind of vague, you know, description of all of that. And this is when I met Alice and Anthony on that day in the morning. So I don't know what to add now, but maybe Alice has something to say about this meeting. But that was basically a meeting. And then about the sparks, about, you know, Colette's story, that happened, you know, at lunchtime, because before that, we were working on something else, on a project for small portraits of veterans for a video game. And I didn't even know that detail at the time. I learned that later on. So it was kind of a secret plan, a secret project probably for them. And then, you know, during lunch, I think that Alice went to the restrooms, and then Anthony asked me very basic questions. We had a casual discussion about our families and so on. And then he said, we want to do more than what we have now. So do you know a French resistant? I said, yes, I know the right person for you. And I was kind of enthusiastic, you know, to speak about her. Because I, you know, when you listen to Colette, and for those of our watchers that have been on tour with Colette, you know, during those dinners, you know that how the vivid memory of her life, you know, during the war is so powerful. And that was, you know, she's a character, and she has, you said it's only one slice. I think, Nathan, you're absolutely right. It's only one slice of Colette in the documentary. But, you know, she was a nurse, age 16, at the military hospital, and so on. So I spoke about this personality, and I said, you know, her two brothers were in concentration camps. She was a nurse at 16, age 16, in Bayeux, where I live. She experienced, you know, she has an incredible life experience, and she said, but do you think she would agree to see her? I said, I have no idea. And they asked me for a telephone number. I said, yes, but I have to call her first. Maybe that surprised them, but for everybody who knows her, that makes sense. So, and Colette answered positively to the request. And a few months later, because this was in April 2018, and I think, correct me if I'm wrong, Alice, I think it was in October that they filmed the first portrait, the first scene, that they couldn't make it in 5 minutes with so many stories of Colette.
Yeah, and we'll come to Alisa's side of this story in just a second. But first, for Colette, you get a call from Christophe about a filmmaker's, and you get on the phone with them, what did you first think about a film being made about you?
Donc, il vous a posé la question de vous rencontrer, ils vous ont appelé pour faire un film. Qu'est-ce que vous avez pensé la première fois que vous avez entendu parler de ce projet?
La toute première fois, on a juste fait une interview avec Alice. Et c'est la deuxième, le deuxième, et c'est surtout quand vous avez investi mon appartement en virant tout le mobilier.
So the very first time, it was just an interview with Alice. It's only the second time then they talked about the film. But the her most vivid memory is when they arrived to do the interview and cleared her whole apartment of any furniture to make room.
C'était un petit peu amusant. Mais
that was very funny.
C'est surtout parce que là, il n'a pas été question d'une interview quelconque, d'une action de vedette quelconque. Il a été question d'un pèlerinage.
What really interested her is that it wasn't any interview, it wasn't just about the story. It was about going to Germany. It was about a pilgrimage.
Voilà. Ça, c'était important pour moi. Parce que je l'ai toujours dit, les voyages touristiques à but culturel, soi-disant, je n'aurais pas pu le faire.
Because that's what was very important to her, because she always thought that the tourist voyages with a cultural purpose to Germany, that she would never have been able to do it.
Même si les gens qui vous accompagnent sont des gens absolument parfaits, vous avez autour de vous 40 personnes qui bavardent, vous ne pouvez pas vous recueillir. Et là, nous n'étions qu'avec la petite Lucie qu'ils ont réussi
when you do a trip like this and there's 40 people around you, you can't properly pay your respects. Whereas the way she did it with only Lucy, that was better. And it was great to find Lucy in her museum and her studies.
Ce pèlerinage n'a été supportable pour moi que. Bon, il y avait cette petite jeune fille, il ne faut pas oublier qu'elle avait 17 ans, l'âge auquel mon frère a été arrêté. Et donc, c'est quand même fragile, 17 ans. Donc, ça me donnait en même temps la responsabilité de m'occuper d'elle.
This, she was only able to bear this pilgrimage thanks to Lucy and the fact that she was 17, which happens to be which is the same age as her brother when he died, and so she felt a responsibility towards her.
Mais ce qui a rendu ce pèlerinage supportable, c'est que j'ai jamais vu une caméra.
And what also made it bearable, acceptable, was the fact that she never saw a camera.
Voilà. Alors Jimmy, il doit savoir ça, lui, parce que c'est un acteur.
Jimmy, you must know this because you're an actor.
Voilà. Donc, un acteur, il a un scénario.
Ouais, un scénario.
Voilà. Et on lui dit tourner à droite, il tourne à droite. Et moi, j'ai fait ce que je voulais. C'est les techniciens, chapeau, qui suivaient mes vagabondages.
So, she was not like an actor who has a script and has to turn right when the script says to turn right. She was free to move around as she felt, and it was the technician that she greatly admires that were following her.
Donc, ce n'était pas un caprice, mais vous imaginez une actrice qui, sur une scène, a décidé de jouer sa partition toute seule. Le réalisateur, il serait fou.
So je suis pas sûr de comprendre ce que. Moi,
j'ai fait ce que je voulais tout le temps.
Yeah, she was able to do whatever what she wanted, and so it wasn't like an actress that would just go off script and get the director completely crazy.
And I think
Jimmy, que personne ne m'a jamais donné un ordre.
You realize, Jimmy, that nobody even ever gave her an order, not even once.
Well, first of all, and that's, I think that's the beauty of documentaries, and that's what was so appealing to me in watching. So many things were, but just trying to, typically documentary filmmakers, and this was crafted so well, you're trying to get a story and you're pushing buttons for, you know, someone to get deep into what the director's trying or the producers are trying to get. And for this particular subject, you couldn't do that. So I found it fascinating how well done the producers and the directors stood away and let you do what you do. And that's a testament to them. And that's why it was honored so well and so received so well in the filmmaking community, because us who know filmmakers, we can see how great that was and how respectful they were.
Thank you.
Elise, maybe we'll go to your side of things, getting to know Colette and crafting this journey that she takes.
Yes, so when we first met Colette, I go back from the beginning of the story, going through Christophe, Colette and Jimmy. So when we first met Christophe, in fact, we were creating educational content for video game. So what we wanted to do was educational, and it was all about transmission. And and Christophe told us that he knew this former resistant woman who was extremely interesting and strong to transmit her story. So we met Colette. And I often say, I will say this again, what struck me in Colette is that she had vivid memories of the war. When she talks about the war, you have the feeling that you are with her during these years. You are with her in front of a house, looking at the German passing by. She has quite an authoritative tone that surrounded a very tender tone. So she's this amazing indeed character, and a woman we wanted to that deserved much more than an interview. The first interview we made, what we felt it was so strong while we did this interview that we thought we need to go to embark with her on a real story. How to do this? With honesty and respect, we try to build around Colette a nest of trust. We spent months discussing what it would mean to go to Dora, to pay tribute to her brother, and what it would mean in her life, and what she would like, how she would imagine it would make sense to her. That's how we, during this conversation, we found the young Lucie at La Coupole Delphaux in the near Saint-Omer. And we discovered that Lucie could, through her studies, because she was working on this book about the French deportees to Dora, she could make deeper research on Jean-Pierre. And we introduced Lucie and Colette, and in front of the camera, they meet for the first time. They met for the first time. And afterwards, so I go to your description, Jimmy, about how we filmed when we were in the camp. In fact, as Colette says, we were going at Colette's rhythm. We adapted, it was quite organic. Colette, we had this bond of trust. So Colette was probably comfortable to do whatever she wanted and to lead us where she wanted to go. So this is how sometimes we had such a strong emotion coming, because this was inside Colette. And I believe also because she felt a responsibility for Lucie. She wanted to transmit her story to Lucie, but also to help Lucie going through this difficult pilgrimage. And the bond between them created this emotion.
And so I'd like to ask Colette now about that bond that she develops with the 17-year-old Lucie, who escorts her to Mittelbau Dora in Germany.
Nathan vous demande justement quel lien vous avez créé avec Lucie, cette jeune fille de 17 ans qui vous a amené à Dora, enfin avec qui vous étiez à Dora.
Elle m'appelle sa grand-mère de substitution, ou sa troisième grand-mère, je crois.
Lucina calls her third grandmother or substitute grandmother.
Et moi, je reste en rapport avec cette jeune fille dont nous allons regarder la carrière, parce que elle va nous faire une belle carrière, indiscutablement.
And she's in contact with her, and she's looking forward to see how she evolves and what kind of career she's going to make for herself. But it's undoubtable that she's going to do great things.
La première fois que nous l'avons vue, Alice et Anthony, elle n'avait pas, à 17 ans, elle n'avait pas encore eu l'occasion de prendre le train. Et après, elle s'est retrouvée en Allemagne, en Amérique. En un temps record, cette jeune fille a mûri.
The first time that Colette and Alice met Lucie, she'd never even taken a train. And now she's been to Germany, she's been to the US, she's grown immensely.
C'est formidable.
It's amazing.
Mais tout à l'heure, Lucie parlait de...
Alice.
Elle a compris. Alice parlait de notre interview. Ce qu'il y a, c'est que quand Alice est arrivée chez moi pour la première fois, les personnes qu'elle avait vues dans le but de faire leur film d'animation, c'était forcément la deux ou troisième génération qui parlait des aventures de leur grand-père, de grand-oncle, des cousinages. Mais ce n'était pas du vrai.
Going back to what Alice was saying earlier, when they first met that first interview, of course, Colette says that anybody that they had met prior to Colette were second or third generation after the war, people who could tell story, but it wasn't the real story, it wasn't the lived story.
Et d'un seul coup, ils ont une première main avec les documents qui vont avec.
And they found, with Colette, they found an eyewitness with documents that she had that went with it.
Hello. Can I say something? Like, because I really want to underline the strength of Colette's voice, because indeed there are not many, but they are still survivors of the war. But the strength of your voice makes it very different from any survivors.
C'est vrai que j'ai des amis anciens déportés ou anciens résistants qui sont dont la mémoire est vraiment défaillante, ou qui parfois leur mémoire a été polluée par tout ce que l'on raconte depuis la fin de la guerre.
It's true, she says that it's true that she's got friends, veterans or friends that were deported to Germany, whose memory is now failing them, or whose memory has been shaped by everything that has been said and told and about the war since the end of the war.
And capturing stories like this and the documentaries and the legacy of film is so important in keeping that memory going. I want to move a little bit into, you know, scenes in the film and what makes it and what doesn't. But one scene that jumped out to a lot of us that know Colette was the restaurant scene in Nordhausen, where the former mayor decides to drop by and give a speech. And I think that might be an unexpected moment on this film journey. So if Colette wants to talk a little bit about what happened in Nordhausen.
Donc, qu'est-ce qui s'est passé au restaurant à Nordhausen?
Pour parler de la scène du restaurant, il faut remonter quelques heures avant.
To talk about that scene in the restaurant, you need to go back a few hours before it happened.
La journée avait forcément été redoutable. J'avais quand même déjà plus de 90 ans. J'étais très fatiguée et normalement.
So the day had been extremely difficult. She was, you know, she was more than 90 years old already, and she was extremely tired. And normally,
le restaurant devait être privatisé.
And normally the restaurant was supposed to have been privatized.
Or, quand je suis rentrée dans le restaurant, la première chose sur laquelle je suis tombée, c'est qu'à gauche, il y avait un groupe d'Allemands facilement 60-70 ans, la chope à la main et qui parlait très fort.
But when she arrived, the first thing she saw was on her right a group of Germans in their 60s with large beards speaking very loudly.
Et pour moi, le parler guttural germanique est déjà une agression.
And to her, these strong German voices were very aggressive.
Donc nous rentrons dans le restaurant, on s'installe tous à table, nous étions 16 quand même.
So they still get into the restaurant, they sit down at the table, there were 16 of them.
Et le groupe d'Allemands qui aurait dû être à l'entrée un peu plus loin se déplace et vient se placer devant le bar qui était somme toute juste en face de nous. On avait l'impression d'être au zoo.
So, and this group of German men that could have moved away actually moved to the bar close, even closer to the table. She felt like she was in a zoo.
Or, à ce moment-là, quand même, quelqu'un est venu pour prendre les commandes.
And someone came, a waiter came to take their order.
Une dame complètement paumée.
A lady that seemed completely lost.
Qui prenait les commandes. N'oubliez pas, c'est mon métier, la restauration.
She was taking orders, but never forget that this was Colette's job. This was her work, restaurant.
Elle a tellement bien pris les commandes que nous étions 16 et elle a servi 15 couverts et Alice n'avait pas du tout de nourriture.
She took their orders so well that there were 16 of them and 15 plates came in and Alice never got any food.
Et pendant ce temps-là, le patron était dans son bar en train de se piquer le nez avec le chef de cuisine qui n'était pas foutu de sortir sa couvert, mais qui était en train de se lever le nez.
And while this was happening, the owner of the restaurant was at the bar drinking with the cook who could not get 16 plates out of his kitchen.
Alors, j'ai envoyé la moitié de mon assiette, enfin, voilà.
She sent back half her plates.
C'était déjà une fin de journée très fatigante.
It was a very tiring end of the day.
Comme j'avais un interprète en allemand qui était assis à ma droite, mais comme quand il a pris la parole, le docteur Scherber, ou un nom comme ça, je ne sais plus, parlait tellement fort qu'il aurait fallu qu'il me parle vraiment dans l'oreille, je ne comprenais rien.
So Colette had a German interpreter sitting on her right, but the mayor was talking so loudly that she couldn't hear any of the translation.
Je voyais que ça tournait et continuait. À un moment, j'ai dit à l'interprète, je dis, vous dites que j'apprécie, je comprends très bien, mais c'est suffisant. Il était en train de remonter le ton, enfin c'était, j'avais entendu l'Allemagne de l'Est ou l'Ouest, enfin...
So time was passing, and after a while, Colette told her interpreter to politely ask him to stop. It was going on and on and on, and she was getting, he was talking about West and East Germany.
Ça n'en sortait pas. Une deuxième fois, je dis, ça suffit, arrêtez, ça continue. Le caméraman Il avait deux Allemands. C'est son boulot. Je reproche rien. Il continuait.
A second time, she asked again to stop. The camera was rolling. It was the cameraman's job. Of course, he kept filming.
Et moi, je sais que j'étais en train, j'allais m'évanouir. J'étais en train de me trouver mal.
And she felt ill. She felt lightheaded. She thought she was going to pass out.
Ça allait vraiment pas bien.
She wasn't well at all.
Pas question de m'évanouir en terre allemande quand même. Faut pas pousser.
There was no way she was going to pass out on German soil.
Debout. Et à ce moment-là, j'ai claqué en disant voilà.
And so that's when she clapped and said that's it.
Et j'ai fait venir à ma droite deux des garçons, des techniciens, pour qu'ils me tiennent très serré avec la table contre moi et le dossier pour être sûr de ne pas m'écrouler.
And she then asked two of the guys, the technicians, to sit right tightly next to her on each side and get the table close so that she knew she would not fall in any direction.
Les malheureux gamins, les deux techniciens, ils étaient serré, comprenez pas pourquoi, serré.
The two poor kids, she was asking them to get closer and closer and closer. And they didn't understand why she was asking that.
Mais je suis restée debout.
But she was still standing. She stayed standing.
Voilà l'histoire du restaurant.
That's the story of the restaurant.
Alors, je vous explique. Attends, Jimmy, tout le monde. Nous ne sommes pas allés en Allemagne pour rouvrir des plaies. Ce n'était pas notre destination ni notre intention.
So let me tell you, Nathan, Jimmy and the others, she didn't go to Germany to reopen old wounds.
Donc j'avais été évidemment désagréable, mais quand je suis colère, je ne suis pas facile. J'avais été évidemment désagréable avec cet homme-là.
So she, of course, she was désagréable, rude to this man. But when she's angry, she's not easy.
Pour une fois qu'il reprenait le micro, il voulait pas le lâcher.
But as long as he held the mic, he didn't want to leave it.
Alors, à son camarade qui était présent aussi, qui est l'ancien commissaire divisionnaire de Nordhausen.
So to his friend, who's a policeman in Nordhausen.
Oui. Qui a d'ailleurs créé un musée là-bas pour Jean-Pierre, enfin c'est autre chose. Et j'ai écrit à ce monsieur John Bonich, parce que je ne connaissais pas les coordonnées du docteur ancien, du maire, docteur, je ne sais pas. Je lui ai envoyé une lettre, non pas pour m'excuser, mais pour expliquer le pourquoi, de façon à ce qu'il ne se sente pas humilié.
So she wrote to this man, the mayor's friend. She did not have the mayor's contact information, but she wrote to her friend not to apologize, but to explain what happened so that he would not feel humiliated.
Et depuis, le docteur et John m'ont répondu que j'avais parfaitement raison, que la bouffe avait été dégueulasse, le service lamentable, et que depuis, ils avaient un autre restaurant où, beaucoup plus convenable, où ils m'attendaient avec beaucoup d'espoir.
And so since then, she's heard from the mayor and his friend, and they agreed with her that the food was terrible and service was appalling, and since then, they now go to another a nicer restaurant where they are waiting to invite her.
Voilà l'histoire du restaurant.
That's the whole story of the restaurant.
And the other thing that anyone who meets Colette comes away with is the World War II stories that she has and her long career in hospitality and how she will not stand for any substandard service in any place that we go. So Elise, this is, you know, sort of one part of a lot of filming that I'm sure you've done, and this question has come in from some of our viewers as well. How much film did you have, and how did you have to cut this down into the 25 minutes?
We filmed 2 days in Normandy. The first interview and then before the trip, We film 2 days, also, 1 day for Lucie, 2 days in Normandy for Colette. Then the trip, the travel to Germany, so it was another day. Then 2 days in Germany. So I would say we filmed a full week, maybe a bit more. And then afterwards, we also recorded interview on the radio. I came back to Colette to do more interviews. So we had 8 days of filming, which is quite long. But in this, when you make a film, in fact, you draw the story, which was the experience of Colette, and we cut everything that was maybe taking us out of the story or would make us wonder instead of going at the pace of the final story. So finally, it's 25 minutes, but it's really because this is how the best story we could do with the footage was edited out of the film. And so for this, I know that Anthony would also mention Aaron Matthews, who is our extraordinary editor, because this is, you might know this, Jimmy, like it's all about sometimes less is more. And so when you take exactly what you need, you have the story that blossoms.
And Jimmy, as someone in the know in the business who can appreciate what goes into producing this, what
sorry Nathan,
about this film? Oui.
Sorry, Nathan, Colette wants to add something.
Yeah.
Je regrette infiniment de ne jamais avoir pu voir toute la durée du film au camp de déportation, pas avant, pas après. Avant les coupures que Monsieur Mathieu, comment il a dit, Serge Mathieu, a décidé. Alice m'avait toujours dit que je verrais l'ensemble avant le découpage. J'ai jamais rien vu et ça, je le regrette profondément.
She would very much like to see the whole footage at the camp, not just the edited version at the end, but everything that had been filmed at the camp.
Alors, est-ce que ce sera possible un jour de voir l'intégrité du reportage dans le camp?
Well, she's asking Alice if it's possible one day to see the whole thing.
What I can say, Colette, is that it's making a film is like a sculpture. So if you take out a lot of things that are that don't make the story, and that you could see some footage, but it would be without telling a story. But what I can say, Colette, what I can say is that the your message has been transferred to Matthew, Aaron Matthews, and Anthony Giacchino. Voilà. They know this, as you asked me.
Oui, allez-y.
Il est temps parce que j'ai 93 ans, j'aurais pu voir ça avant de mourir quand même.
She's 93. She'd like to see it before she passes away.
Parce que la parole, Jimmy, je voudrais qu'il me dise d'abord s'il est italien du nord ou du sud et qu'est-ce qu'il faisait dans le film. Son rôle, c'était lequel?
She's asking. She wants to know whereabouts in Italy is Jimmy's family from, and what was your role in Band of Brothers?
Thank you, Colette. My mother's side is from Naples, a small town north of Naples called Caserta, and my father's Sicilian. He's from Sicily.
Parle pas beaucoup avec les mains.
You don't speak much with the hands.
Les Siciliens, ça parle pas avec les mains. Les Siciliens, ça parle plutôt avec un pistolet.
Well, except Sicilians who don't speak with hands, they speak with guns.
There are a lot of people on this panel and a lot of people listening and watching that know me, that have traveled with the museum. They will let you know, all I do is talk with my hands. I'm just trying to...
Son rôle, c'était quel rôle?
And your role in Band of Brothers?
Yep. I played Sergeant Frank Percanti, an Italian guy from Joliet, Illinois. And he was one of the first men to sign up for the paratroopers.
Did you learn to jump?
They would not allow us to jump for insurance reasons. After the filming, yes, but if Steven Spielberg and Tom Hanks heard that you were jumping out of a plane before filming started, you probably would have lost your job.
Ils n'avaient pas le droit de sauter pendant le parce que pour voilà et mais il a sauté après que ça ait été de trompant.
C'était trop cher avant de se tuer en parachute.
It would have cost too much if you'd gotten killed jumping.
Yeah, halfway through production wouldn't be good if you didn't make the rest of the series.
Yeah.
Bravo, yeah, that's pretty universal.
Well, I'll start to talk on my hands now that she allowed me. Now they come out.
So Jimmy, if we could get your with the hands, if we could get your take on the film and some of the technical aspects you noticed.
Well, when I first did the film, I got casted over here. No. So, first of all, to me, the most fascinating thing about Colette's story and the film itself was it is so difficult to get something off the ground. And I'll try not to spend too much time on this because I know there's a lot of questions for Colette. It's so much work to try and get a film made in any capacity, whether it's documentary, TV, or film on any level. And when you have such an idea of what you want to do, and when you get there, you find a new story, a new subject, something that just needs to be told, an educational subject, and now you're building a team to go out there and now go to this route. So in other words, what we like to say is you punted and went with a whole new story. That to me is amazing in itself, because everything that has to go into that, trying to put together your package and producing that and documentary, raising money and all the waivers and the story in itself and the editors. And she said it earlier, Alice, is I always say you make three movies. It's, you know, it's the one that's written, it's the one that is produced and shot, and then it's the one that's edited. So you literally make three movies, but the one that edited is the one that we all see. So it's really important to have an editor that understands exactly your vision and what you are seeing. So that stood out. That was remarkable to me that they just went at a lunch. We have to do this. And then to try to you got in touch with Christophe and figure out a way to approach Colette. I've been around a lot of the World War II heroes, and you don't want to open up these old wounds. It's touchy. I can't imagine what it was like to approach Colette and kind of say, hey, we'd like to do a documentary. And to do it so well and so tasteful and so respectful and how powerful that story was, and her voice and bringing Lucy on board, the way that was weaved was just brilliant to me. It's very, very challenging. And I think Colette, it'd be wonderful for you to see the footage of you in there. And I'm sure Alice and her team can get that to you.
So the film gets released, it makes its rounds on the film circuit, and it culminates with this win of the Oscar. And I want to throw this to Christophe and then to Colette. How has the film been received in Normandy, and What's it been like for you guys since the Oscars?
I was thinking about how to put in words this experience, and I think that we could say that Colette could run for president next year. She's very famous. That's extraordinary, really. But there is something special about this film. You know, it's about Colette. It's about Jean-Pierre as well. We didn't mention his name. I'm sure that if we don't say Jean-Pierre until the end, Colette will be very upset about that. But, you know, that's a victory. And this film really brought back to life Jean-Pierre in a way. And I think that touched the public, really. So the audience was ready to listen to that type of story. I think in the US, according to what I've been told, but in France as well. And she had many good interviews. So I lost track of all the interviews she did with many major French presenters of national broadcast, journalists, you know, from newspapers. And I really that I think that nobody can ignore Jean-Pierre's story, and Colette became the brand of all of that. And that's kind of interesting that she was really famous locally, you know what I mean? But now it's nationwide. And even internationally. So that's why Alice and Anthony allowed to do for her. And you know that she says, and she will probably tell it better than me, but she says that Jean-Pierre is now out of night and fog, you know, that the Nazis intended to put him in. And I think really that's the way I feel it personally. And I think this fame is something only positive. You know what I mean? It's a tragedy, but it turned into something so positive finally. That there is a really a mixed feelings, I would say, on my side. But for the public, it's just so amazing, so interesting to see somebody so fresh, you know, speaking so freshly. I'm thinking now about Pierre, really. He has a very difficult job translating Colette with a... You know, it's kind of difficult to have the subtlety of language. You know what I mean? In any language, we are translators, we are tour guides. We are here to transform emotions and personal stories into a big story that makes sense for people in our tours. That's the same thing that Alice and Anthony did. And that's the way that Colette also, she works again. I mean, that she will tell you that she sometimes answers emails at 3 a.m. until 3 a.m. So past midnight, really, and about every day. And she's 92 years old. So that's an incredible performance. And she became famous because of the hard work she put in and the emotions she brought to the public that people probably were waiting for.
And so Colette's thoughts on this film, the awards, and the extra attention that she's getting.
Ce que vous pensez du film, de la sa réception de l'Oscar et de l'attention que vous recevez maintenant.
Ce que je pense du film, j'en ai dit tout le bien qu'il était nécessaire d'en dire. À mon avis, c'est un devoir.
She feels about the film, first of all, she feels like she's told all the she said all the good that is necessary to say about this film, and she feels it's her duty to say it, to promote it.
Alors Christophe parle de la réception du film en France. Moi, je peux vous dire qu'il a été reçu en Belgique, en Espagne, en Italie aussi. Je ne sais pas si j'ai lien, mais en Italie aussi.
So Christophe was talking about the reception in France, but it's been seen and shown in Belgium, in Spain, in Italy.
Voilà. Bon, j'ai reçu à peu près une cinquantaine, j'ai effectué au moins une cinquantaine d'interviews avec caméra, avec son, avec tout ce que vous voudrez.
She's done at least 50 interviews now with cameras and radios and everything you can think of.
Alors, tant qu'il fait jour, dans la journée, c'est le téléphone, les visites et les vidéos.
So during daytime, it's she's busy with the telephone visits and video conferences like this.
Toute la journée.
All day.
Et les courriels et le courrier papier. C'est la nuit.
And mail and emails, she takes care of that in evening and at night.
Alors, j'ai un paquet ici où il y a 47, je crois, lettres papier auxquelles j'ai répondu par un courrier.
So she's got a folder there on the right of the 47 letters that she's
ça fait une jolie épaisseur.
That she's replied to.
Et les mails, les courriels, notre amie commune à vous deux là, les garçons, a calculé que j'étais presque aux 300.
And emails, we've got a friend in common that has calculated that she received more than 300 emails.
Je vous jure que ça fait des très petites nuits.
I tell you that it makes for very short nights.
Alors j'ai quand même une surprise. Je viens d'être invitée pour faire une conférence au Sénat.
She was very she did get a surprise. She was just invited to do a conference at the Senate.
Et dans la foulée.
And just after it.
Le président de la République qui a dû être jaloux, eh ben, il m'invite.
And just after it, the French president, who must be jealous, has invited her.
À réception à l'Élysée et la célèbre cérémonie du Mont Valérien, où il me remettra la décoration posthume pour mon frère de la médaille de. Je vais y arriver.
Lors
de la libération. À titre posthume.
And she. So she's been invited at the Elysium Palace where the French president is, and then at the very important ceremony at the Mont Valérien, where she will receive the Order of the Liberation, which is a medal on behalf of her brother.
Là, je sens que je vais encore faire mes 35 heures en deux jours.
She's gonna be busy again for a few days.
Oui, bah oui, faut bien tenir le coup. On va pas déserter au milieu.
But you have to. She has to hold on to continue. She can't desert. She can't abandon the task in the middle.
It's a full-time job.
That's it. C'est un job à plein temps.
Absolument.
Absolutely, yeah.
I'm going to switch to some questions from our audience. And before I do that, one more memory from a student who met Colette in 2017. Lydia wrote us that she is so inspired by Colette's devotion and joy at then the age of 90, even after she had seen so much pain. So one from 2017, a university student. But our first question from the audience that I kind of pulled out is, Colette's in the resistance. In the film, she mentions joining is not like opening a bank account. You just don't open a resistance bank account. But what were some of the jobs, the tasks that she did?
Donc, une des questions, c'est que dans le film, vous parlez de votre expérience de la résistance et vous dites que rentrer dans la résistance, c'est pas comme ouvrir un compte en banque. Mais donc, du coup, la question, c'est qu'est-ce que vous faisiez exactement dans la résistance?
J'ai tellement dit. Alors, au départ, quand j'étais toute jeune, la seule chose qu'on m'a demandé, quand les troupes allemandes arrivaient en France, c'était de noter les numéros des camions. Parce qu'à ce moment-là, toute la France n'était pas occupée. L'armée française n'avait pas encore demandé l'armistice, merci. Donc, simplement noter les numéros des camions qui montaient de Paris vers Cherbourg.
So at the very start of the war, as France was being invaded and had not signed an armistice yet, her first job was to write down the license plates of German trucks that were passing by their house.
Bon, alors j'étais donc, si vous voulez, une jeune écolière assise sur une marche de son perron en train de faire ses devoirs.
So she was. So officially, she was just a young schoolgirl sitting on the on the steps in front of her house doing her schoolwork.
Mais quand on rentre en résistance, c'est comme en amour, on met le petit doigt et tout le reste y pense.
But entering the resistance is like falling in love. You start with a bit of your finger and you end up with a whole body in love.
Parce que après, on m'a demandé d'aller porter à la mairie des papiers qu'il fallait tamponner. J'allais donc à la mairie avec un papier à tamponner que la secrétaire de mairie, qui savait parfaitement qu'il était faux, tamponnait quand même. Et je rentre à la maison avec le papier tamponné. Dites-moi s'il y a vraiment beaucoup d'héroïsme là-dedans.
She was then asked to go to the town hall to get a stamp on papers. They were fake papers, but and the lady at the town hall knew that perfectly, but she would still put the stamp on it, and then she would just walk back to the her house. And she says she added, "Tell me if there's nothing heroic in what I did."
Oui. D'autres questions? Oui, alors.
Next question.
D'autres choses que j'ai fait.
No, something else that she did.
Il était interdit, sous peine de mort, de fleurir la tombe, soit des aviateurs abattus, soit des résistants fusillés.
It was forbidden under penalty of death to put flowers on the graves of downed Allied pilots or French resistance that had been shot.
Donc impossible de demander cela à une fleuriste professionnelle.
So you couldn't ask flowers at a flower shop to for the graves.
Donc mon travail était de fabriquer des gerbes, qu'on appelle des raquettes, des grandes gerbes de fleurs. Alors je ne vais pas vous raconter, il faut du bois, du foin, de la ficelle, du fil de fer, du bambou, peu importe.
So one of her job was to make wreaths to place on the graves, and she's not going to go through the whole details of how to make a wreath, but you need wood, you need hay, you need
faire du bamboo,
steel wire.
C'est compliqué.
So it was a bit complicated.
Et comme il y avait des fleurs plein le jardin,
and because there were flowers all around her garden,
je dis toujours, et Pierre Sanel sait bien, la plus belle gerbe que j'ai fabriquée, c'était pour le maire de Lasson, M. Frémont, qui a été fusillé parce qu'il avait donné asile. Alors, la légende dit tantôt un aviateur abattu, tantôt un résistant, je ne sais pas, mais la Gestapo l'a fusillé.
So, she always says that the most beautiful wreath she made and what she remembers was for a Mr. Frémont, who was the mayor of Lasson, who had been shot by the Germans because he had. Either she can't remember if either he'd helped Allied pilots or resistance, but he'd been shot by the Germans. Et c'est Jean-Pierre qui a amené le.
Et c'est Jean-Pierre sur son vélo qui, de nuit forcément, a été porté la gerbe sur sa tombe. La seule chose, c'est que nous savons que la gerbe n'est pas restée longtemps parce que le village aurait subi des représailles.
So they and it's Jean-Pierre, her brother, that went. Brought the wreath at night on his bicycle and put the wreath. Now then the wreath didn't stay on the tomb very long because there would have been reprisals against the village if it had.
Il est bien possible que ce soit la gendarmerie allemande, la police allemande qui l'ait enlevé, ce qui n'est pas pareil que la Gestapo. N'oubliez pas, il y a des.
So, and maybe the German gendarmerie, the French gendarmerie removed it, which, and it was very different, French gendarmerie was very different from the Gestapo.
Peut-être les gens du village pour ne pas avoir de soucis.
Or maybe the village, the people from the village to not get in trouble.
Mais c'était interdit sous peine de mort, donc on l'a fait.
But it was forbidden under penalty of death, so they did it.
D'ailleurs, Jean-Pierre a été arrêté parce qu'il avait fleuri le monument aux morts de Bretteville l'Orgueilleuse, qu'il a été dénoncé par le type qui habitait en face, qui avait un bureau de tabac.
And that's what happened. Jean-Pierre was arrested because he had put flowers on the memorial monument to the death of World War One, and he'd been denounced, he'd been told on by a neighbor that saw him put it.
Donc d'ailleurs, ce type a été arrêté, ensuite il a été condamné.
And that guy ended up being arrested and sentenced après la guerre.
Voilà, mais la seule chose, c'est que après avoir arrêté Jean-Pierre et en ayant enquêté, évidemment, là, ils ont découvert que non seulement il avait posé cette verbe, mais qu'il faisait partie d'un réseau. Et c'est là qu'ils ont tous été arrêtés.
But the thing is, when Jean-Pierre was arrested just for placing flowers, there was an inquiry by the Germans, and that's when they realized that he was part of a whole resistance network, and that's how the whole network fell.
Avec un autre de ses camarades, qui s'appelait Louis Le Canu, et qui lui est mort très vite. Il est mort quelques mois après.
And so he was arrested with a comrade of his called Louis Le Canu, who actually died quickly afterwards.
Jean-Pierre était un très grand sportif, mais vraiment un sportif. Et il avait gagné les championnats de traversée de Caen à la nage, il faisait du plongeon en vol, il faisait du tennis, il faisait du football, il faisait 30 km tous les jours en vélo pour aller de la propriété jusqu'à ses cours.
So Jean-Pierre was very fit. He played a lot of sports. He was swimming. He was playing football. He was riding 30 kilometers every day to get to his on his bicycle to get to his to school.
Donc il a tenu le coup 2 ans.
So he was strong enough to hold on for 2 years.
Il meurt 10 jours avant la libération de son camp.
And died 10 days before the liberation of the camp.
Par les Américains.
By the Americans.
Il est mort le 20 mars 45.
On the 20th of March 1945.
Voilà. Il avait été arrêté en début août 43.
He was arrested in early August 1943.
A follow-up question. This comes from Robin Cole. How did you decide who you could trust?
Une autre question d'un monsieur Robin Cole. Comment vous saviez à qui vous pouviez faire confiance?
Personne.
No one.
C'est simple, à personne.
It's very simple, you couldn't trust anyone.
On avait, quand on passait les documents, on les donnait, on les remettait à mon père. Mon père officiellement habitait Caen. Arrivé à Caen, je n'ai jamais su, si après-guerre j'ai su à qui les donner. Mais pendant la guerre.
So all the documents she would give to her father, and her father at that time officially was living in Caen, and she never knew who his contact was. She learned who it was after the war, but not during the war.
Si vous connaissiez 3 personnes, ils arrêtaient 3 personnes, vous donniez les noms de 3 personnes. S'il y en a un qui sous la torture parlait. C'était pas 3 personnes, c'était un réseau entier. Si vous ne connaissiez qu'une personne et qui ne parle pas, tout le reste du réseau était sauvé.
If you knew three people and any one of them cracked under torture, then the whole network would have fallen. If you only knew one person, then you protected the network.
So another question, this from Francis Peters, and this will come after the D-Day and the liberation, about Colette serving as a nurse. Where did she nurse and who did she nurse? Were these French? Were they allies?
Une autre question à propos de votre travail comme infirmière. Où est-ce que vous étiez infirmière? De qui est-ce que vous occupez, des Français, des Alliés?
Alors, c'est certainement la période de ces années noires que je préfère et dont je suis le plus fier. Je résume.
It's certainly, first of all, it's the period of throughout this whole the whole war, the period where she was a nurse is the one where she's that she prefers and that she's the most proud of.
Nous avions dans la résistance un ordre précis de se mettre à la disposition du premier corps constitué en camp de bataille de libération, de débarquement.
In the resistance, they had a very strict order that in case of a landing, they were to find and put themselves at the disposal of the first constituted allied unit.
Voilà, bon, on aurait ça faire sa petite résistance tout seul.
You weren't allowed to do your own little resistance.
Donc, je suis allé me mettre aux ordres au poste de commandement des officiers de liaison, on va dire, forcément.
Canadien. No.
Oui, oh, bah, y a eu tous les...
Right. So she got in contact with liaison officers.
Et oui, Canadiens, ils ont... Il faut d'abord.
Canadians, British.
Il faut vous dire d'abord que je vais faire avec les mains. Vous avez Bretteville-Orgueilleuse, vous avez le village de Roux.
Alors attendez, parce que ça c'est très difficile à traduire.
She's
showing with her hands
des villages.
Her village, village, Roux, so Bretteville and Roux.
Et en bas, ici, un autre village.
And then below, there's another village and it forms a triangle.
Bon, les Alliés ont appelé ça le triangle maudit.
This triangle, the Allies called it the triangle of doom.
Quand il y avait un nouveau régiment, c'est pas parce que le premier était parti au repos, parce qu'ils étaient morts.
When a new regiment came in, it wasn't because the previous one had gone resting. It was because it was just they were all dead.
C'est pour ça que je ne sais pas si c'était des régiments canadiens, australiens. Voilà, ça changeait trop.
So she can't remember all of the regiments, the Canadians, etc., because it was changing too much.
Peu importe, ce qu'ils avaient besoin, c'était des renseignements sur les petits chemins de terre dans une, c'est la campagne normande. Hein.
But what they needed was information on the small country lanes in the Norman countryside.
Et moi, ça faisait des années que je faisais ça en vélo.
And she'd been cycling around on her bicycle for years around the place.
Alors, c'est bien plus facile pour un militaire. Qui a sa carte d'état-major avec des numéros et qui doit tenir le volant, s'il sait qu'il doit tourner à la grande pancarte où il y a marqué n'importe quoi à droite.
It's much easier for a soldier to know that at this sign you need to turn right rather than have to look at the map at the military map.
Ça allait beaucoup plus vite. Et un jour nous sommes partis en reconnaissance avec deux médecins après la prise du village de Noray-en-Bessin.
And one day after the capture of the village of Noray-en-Bessin, they went to with a military doctor as do a reconnaissance with the military doctor.
Et quand nous sommes arrivés dans le village, derrière la troupe d'assaut forcément, nous avons trouvé les survivants du massacre de la population par la USN. Hessen-Hugen-SS.
And as they arrived in the village following the assault troops, they found the remains of the massacre of part of the population of the village by the Hitler-Jugend division.
Toute la population était dans un seul abri. Ils ont mis deux grenades anti-char.
All the civilians had taken refuge in a shelter, and the SS sent two anti-tank grenades in the shelter.
22 morts, 16 blessés graves.
22 were killed, 16 were gravely wounded.
Les Alliés se sont occupés aussitôt de tous les grands blessés qu'ils ont emmenés dans leurs hôpitaux sous tente, leurs hôpitaux de ligne.
Allied troops took care of anyone that was very badly wounded. They were brought to military hospitals.
Mais ils ne pouvaient pas se charger des blessés légers.
But they couldn't take care of the more lightly wounded.
Donc ils ont été ramenés chez nous à notre domicile où il y avait un poste de secours.
And so there was an aid station in her house, and the lightly wounded were brought to her house.
Et ça n'a pas duré longtemps parce que les Alliés ont très bien compris que la Hitler-Jugend-SS, je l'ai bien dit ce coup-là, allait faire une contre-attaque. Ils nous ont demandé de partir avec nos blessés et les vieux et ceux qui ne pouvaient pas marcher. Voilà.
But that didn't last very long because the Allies realized the Hitler-Jugend was going to counter-attack, and so they asked them to leave with the wounded, to leave the house with the wounded.
Et il n'y avait pas de taxi, il n'y avait pas de bus, il n'y avait rien.
There was no taxi, there were no buses, there were nothing.
Il n'y avait même plus de voiture automobile.
They didn't even have cars.
Alors on a trouvé des charrettes à bras.
So they brought them on handcarts.
Et on a mis les blessés dedans.
They put the wounded in the handcarts.
Et on est parti vers Bayeux.
And they left heading to Bayeux.
Qui était déjà libéré.
That was already liberated.
Il y a 12 kilomètres.
It's 12 kilometers between...
Mon ami deux jours.
It took them 2 days to do the 12 kilometers, 8 miles.
Et quand nous sommes arrivés à Bayeux, avec nos charrettes, alors je raccourcis parce qu'il y a beaucoup d'autres détails, mais on a rencontré des officiers de l'hôpital militaire Robert Lyon. Quand ils ont vu les pansements sur les blessés, ils ont demandé qui avait fait ça.
So when they arrived in Bayeux, she said that she was skipping some details, but when they arrived in Bayeux, they arrived at the Free French Hospital Robert Lyon, and when the doctors saw the wounded and the bandages that had been that they had, the doctors asked who did the bandages.
On ne nous a pas demandé poliment est-ce que vous voudriez aller travailler. On a été enrôlé fermement, très fermement, immédiatement, parce que l'hôpital était en train de se constituer.
So they went, and so eventually they weren't politely. The doctors didn't politely ask them to join the hospital. They were forcibly enrolled in it as the hospital was getting constituted.
Et je peux vous dire que les blessés n'arrivaient pas en ambulance. Les ambulances étaient militaires et elles s'occupaient de leurs soldats. Ça nous arrivait dans des camions, dans des charrettes à bras, dans n'importe quoi.
So, and the wounded were brought to the hospital not in ambulances, which were reserved for the allies and the military, but in trucks, in handcarts, again, anything possible.
Et dans un état lamentable. Comme sortait un blessé du décombre.
And in really poor shape, as wounded had been brought out of rubbles.
Donc, ma mère, j'étais avec ma mère toujours. J'ai toujours été avec ma mère jusqu'à mes 40 ans.
So her mother, and she was always with her mother. She was with her mother until she was 40.
Et ma mère était secouriste depuis la guerre de 14.
And her mother had been a nurse since the First World War.
Parce que, entre parenthèses, on va dire.
On a side note,
ma mère était née en 1885.
Her mother was born in 1885.
Et à la guerre de 14, elle a perdu son papa et ses deux frères.
And her mother had lost her father and two brothers in the First World War.
Et à celle-là, elle a perdu ses deux fils.
And in the Second World War, she lost her two sons.
Alors, ma mère a eu immédiatement du travail, enfin un poste. Mais moi, qu'est-ce qu'on allait faire de cette grande berche de solide comme un roc? Mais j'étais pas, on n'est pas médecin ni infirmière à 16 ans, c'est pas possible.
So her mother was enrolled as a nurse, but what were they going to do with this 16-year-old perche, tall girl? That was strong, but that didn't. But you can't be a nurse. It's a nurse at 16.
Et il fallait bien le faire. Les blessés quand ils arrivaient, ils étaient sales. Il fallait les laver. Leur faire faire pipi, enfin c'était en général la culotte elle était déjà garnie.
So she had to clean the wounded as they were arriving, clean them, make sure they I don't know how to translate that. You know, make sure they could pee and take care of business. You know.
Voilà. Donc mon travail, moi, c'était de les mettre propres pour les donner propres à un chirurgien.
So her job was to get them cleaned up so they could be brought to a surgeon.
Donc mon surnom c'était l'infirmière pipi caca.
So her nickname was the wee and poop nurse.
Voilà. Alors j'ai fait ça pendant 4 mois.
So she did that for 4 years.
Et puis, un hôpital militaire de ligne, c'est fait pour suivre l'armée.
But a frontline hospital is designed to follow follow armies.
Alors, en septembre, on a fait l'inventaire pour lever le camp et suivre l'armée.
So in September, they inventoried everything to pack up everything and move on.
Mais jusque-là, j'étais bénévole.
But up until that point, she was just a volunteer.
Voilà. Donc, j'ai voulu m'engager.
She wanted to enlist.
À ce moment-là, personne ne savait mon âge avant.
Before that, nobody knew her age.
Et quand ils ont vu mon âge, on m'a dit, oh, ben non, mademoiselle, j'ai trop, c'est pas possible, vous êtes trop jeune.
But when they realized her age, they told her that it was impossible, she was way too young.
Ça faisait 4 mois que je faisais le travail et on m'avait même, j'avais même reçu des ordres comme infirmière major.
She'd been working there for 4 months and she'd even received orders where she was referred to as a nurse major.
Alors, ma mère et moi, nous sommes rentrés chez nous à pied.
So her mother and her went home on foot.
Donc, par la scoula, par la nationale.
This time they could take the main road.
Quand nous sommes arrivés chez nous, la maison avait été pillée de tout ce qui avait un peu de valeur marchande.
When they arrived home, they realized the house had been looted and everything that had any value had been taken.
Si mes frères étaient rentrés de déportation, il n'y avait même pas de maison de fringues à leur donner des vêtements.
If her brothers had been survived deportation, they wouldn't even have had clothes.
Le toit avait des trous, le toit de la maison avait des trous par les éclats d'obus.
The roof where it was full of holes.
Notre porte-monnaie aussi.
And so was their wallet.
Mais il a fallu vivre, c'est tout.
So they had to continue to live.
Quite a compelling story, just seeing the faces of our panelists as we went through. We're out of time now, but I want to read one more quote that a student wrote about meeting Colette in 2019. This comes from Mariah, and I think this can sum up all of us who've seen the documentary and just listened to Colette. Meeting her inspired me to be the best person I can be. I took a picture with Colette and got her to sign my museum ticket, and on it she wrote, "Avec toutes mes amitiés." I will always cherish this note from her, from Mariah, 2019. I want to thank our panelists, Christophe, Jimmy, Elise, Pierre, Colette, Constance Whitaker, who's been behind the scenes running the back of house on this. All of our viewers, our members, especially our Patriot Circle members who ensure that we can do what we do at the museum and keeping the memory alive so that documentaries like Colette will continue to inform and inspire future generations. Thank you, everyone.